So Retrospective 2015, welcome to Canal the English. In today's special program, we'll be revisiting major societal, health and education events that mark the year 2015. We have high crime wave, which was visible with ritual killings across Cameroon, particularly in the town of Chang, west region of Cameroon. We'll talk about floods, fire incidents, accidents, demolition exercise, flooding, and of course, an official examinations in Cameroon involving both students and teachers. All these issues would be analyzed by our guests. You're watching Retrospective 2015. To give you in-depth analysis on major happenings in the year 2015, with me in the studio are two gentlemen. On my left, I have Barrister Wangu. You're welcome to the program.
Thank you, Maureen.
I'll start by asking you, the head of state announced a drop in fuel prices in 2016 now. Do you feel the impact already?
Thanks for that question, Maureen. During the head of state New Year message to his compatriots, he announced a drop in the price of fuel. But surprisingly, normally when they see an increase in fuel, the prices of all the goods, they always step up. So we're expecting a slump after this decrease in price. But it's not the same situation we witness in our day-to-day activities.
Now we're talking about what here, that if you go to market, at least if a good was sold at 500 francs, you go to 400 francs. Transport fare too, is that what you're talking about?
Exactly. That has been what we've been experiencing.
Now, we also have on my right Francis Eret. He is an educationist. Welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Now, I want to ask you, have you, did you start the year 2016 on a good note?
Yes, sure. When you plan your year, you always start it on a good foot.
Now, 2015, was it a good year?
Well, 2015 had its downs and ups, but on the whole, it was a good year. And we look forward to a better year in 2016.
Now, I would like us to start with floods. Floods in the city of Douala. There was a general cry on floods across Cameroon, particularly in the city of Douala. The question goes to you, Barrister Wango. Why that repeated floods in a city like Douala?
Thank you, Maureen. We've been having repeated floods due to the lack of good drainage, because most of the time when contracts are road maintenance contracts or construction of roads are awarded to contractors, they don't respect the norms. At times they don't give them enough money to carry out their work. Even if the money is there, you know how the society is corrupt. The person awarding that contract, we want to get a good chunk of that money, so the contractor, they're always unable to do a proper job. And here in Douala, people don't want to build everywhere. They don't respect the topography of the city when they're carrying out constructions. There are certain areas where they don't supposed to construct.
Houses, yeah.
Yeah, but people stubbornly, they go on and construct houses, and then they block the circulation of water passage. So it poses a lot of problems. That's why we always have flood. And then some of the drainage, some of the gutters, they are full with rubbish. The city council, I can't say that. They're not doing their job properly.
And we see them paying youths every year to do the drainage?
It's not every year. You know, they always have a way to steal money. They always have a way to steal the civil servants. They pretend as if they're paying you to do the work. They do it in certain areas, but most of the town, they don't engage same assignment in all the important areas of the city.
Now, Mr. Francis Eret, the causes of floods in the city of Douala are well known. Now, why this problem? Why are we experiencing floods every year in the city of Douala and even in some parts of Cameroon?
Well, we live in a country where town planning policies are poorly implemented. if at all they are implemented. So we're all aware of what's going on, but nobody's bold enough to take the right step to address this issue. We are in a country where corruption has become the number one sport in such a way that today, when roads are being, say, maintained in courts, people are just playing, and then the following week, the layer of tar that you saw being applied goes off. So automatically, we come back to the same things every year, every month. Some years ago, we didn't have this level of floods, but it's like as time goes by, we are increasingly encountering this problem. So what will happen in the next 5 years, we don't know. Maybe we'll get up one day and all of us will be in water because everywhere is blocked. The streets are poorly designed, poorly maintained. People live anywhere, they build everywhere. So it's a crucial problem, and until we have real town planning policies addressed, this issue will not be solved.
Now, we're talking of people constructing on water path, Barrister Wango. Now, and the city of Douala has been demolishing houses. They realize that there are houses which are not demolished.
Yeah, it depends on the owner. You know, I'll give you an example, a glaring example, where somebody constructed along the water path. The workers from the urban council, they were sent there by the government delegate. A certain mayor, he has always in perfect peace, came there and said, no, this building belongs to my son, they cannot demolish.
Cannot demolish the building.
Yes, the people let it go. And there are other houses in Douala built in certain strategic areas. Take, for example, Aram Gange, Babylon. There are houses built on the part of water which they were supposed to demolish. But we don't know why the houses are still there. And it's posing a lot of problems, causing floods. Whenever there's rain, there's flood in that neighborhood. When you look into the gutters, even in front of your office, you see that most of the gutters have been littered. We, the citizens, we need to help the city council also. We have to educate the inhabitants of the city of Douala and elsewhere that they have to help the council. They know how to dispose of their waste because we're helping or we abating this flood. Because if we dispose properly certain categories of waste, we don't litter them into the gutters. And if there is free flow of water, I think it's going to reduce this flood.
Now, before we come to the Douala City Council or pushing down the blame, don't you think the population inhabitants should be blamed too for this, or are responsible for these constant floods in the city of Douala or elsewhere across Cameroon?
Well, the city of Douala particularly is a very cosmopolitan city, with increasingly people coming from the rural areas. And these people coming from the rural areas don't always know how to handle the rubbish in town. So we need to raise awareness, need to educate those people. And you notice that the level of floods depends on the part of the city. The more you go to the slumpy areas where people are less educated, the more you have this problem. So people are not educated on how to dispose their rubbish. People don't know, for example, that you don't build on a slumpy area, because when you build in a slumpy area, you're blocking the passage of water. And this has serious consequences on people's health, on the traffic, and everything else. So who's raising awareness? Nobody.
Now, but government see them constructing on these water paths and nothing is done.
It's Cameroon.
Because a house is not built in a day. It takes months, years, even 2 years to build those houses. And they see them building the house, but they do nothing.
When they are undergoing this construction, the people of the city council or the municipal council, they always come there to, well, what they say, are ready to travel, that they should stop work. But after 2 weeks, you know, come on, you know, civil servants are very corrupt. After 2 weeks, when they go give them bribe, they'll let them go. They'll close their eyes. They'll never come back there. you will come and see the structure completed, and it's going to be difficult to demolish. But if we change the mentality too of Cameroonians, and a lot of things is going to change, because as you already said, houses are not constructed in 1 year, in 1 day, or 2 days. It takes time to do this construction. When you start, they always come to intimidate you because they have a way to extort money from citizens. They use intimidation. They will write a demoni dan karangwite.
At the end of the day,
you'll be fighting. They'll go give them money. They'll let go.
Mm-hmm. Now, let's look at this land certificate. Who awards a land certificate? Don't you see the problem starts from there?
No, most of these houses, most of them, they don't even have land certificate. But if you want to talk about land certificate, want to talk about land issue, starting from the minister, it's a disgrace. Mm-hmm. I'm talking starting from the minister, it's a disgrace. There's a lot of fraud, corruption, when it comes to the issuance of land certificate, especially in Douala. Mm-hmm. Most of the people they call the land register, they call them French conservateur, they are corrupt. They're supposed to be in jail. But we don't know why they are in jail. Mm-hmm. I'm a lawyer. I'm talking. I have witnessed cases where the civil servants, they have connived with what they call this chumet to deprive people of their land. You have instances where this conservator will chumet the issue double land certificate on the same piece of land. So when we're talking about corruption, the lands department is most of them supposed to be in jail.
Now, Francis Arrett, yes. What's your experience when it comes to award of land certificates or land titles?
That's a very complex issue, and I'm very happy to have a lawyer by my side. Because what happens is first of all, in our context, in our historic context, land used to belong to the villagers, and then the state would confiscate the land. There's a law about that which I'm not very familiar with. And then now, when you buy land usually from a villager or from somebody who has been living in that part of town for the past 40 or 50 years, he tells you that the land belongs to him and his family. So when you come buy the land, this person usually will still go and sell that very land to a second person and a third person. And strangely enough, all these people will have authentic documents on the land. So at the end of the day, you realize that those civil servants from the ministries who issued those documents are not blind, because they have a map of each area of town. Mm-hmm. So they're able to identify what land has been sold to who. But they keep selling the same land and issue certificates to the same people.
Now, is there a sanction for that, barrister?
Madam, let me, I want to concur to what Mr. Francis just said, mm-hmm. because it's so disheartening, especially around the neighborhood of Banya, Aquanot, where this practice is order of the day. Mm-hmm. And these people, you file a complaint, they are summoned either at the gendarmerie or at the police, they record their cautionary statement, they go to court, they don't go to jail. Today is very, is bad normal. Mm-hmm. I, a lawyer, I was defending what they call the collectivity, certain family groupings. Mm-hmm. They said they were going to pay me, they were going to compensate me by giving me lands. They gave me lands that belonged to somebody. So can you imagine then what an ordinary Cameroonian is going to face? Mm-hmm. It's so recurrent around the Aqua North vicinity. Mm-hmm. Mbanya, when you say from Pharmacy, Aqua North right up to wrong point, my tube. Mm-hmm. Most of the lands there, they have problems. Mm-hmm. You see somebody who sell a land to 5%.
Because now people are scared of buying land in the city of Douala, especially those, I'm talking of English-speaking part of Cameroonians in the English part of the country. They're scared of buying lands because you buy land today and tomorrow you're demolished 20 years after. You start from square one.
Yes, but madam, if you want to buy land, you have to do some research, some findings. You have to, there are certain issues which you have to know before engaging.
What are those issues?
For
what
example,
are those issues?
It's extremely difficult, and it's not advisable to buy a land, an untitled land. Before you buy a land, make sure that land has a title. Mm-hmm. And that sale must go to a notary public. Mm-hmm. I had a case that was 2 weeks ago. I don't want to call the name of this notary public, where he received my client, all the documents were prepared, received money from my client. This same notary public was trying to sell this land to somebody else and then to reimburse my client. When I intervened, he had to change his bad intention. You have lands here in Douala which they are untitled, owned by what they call the autochtones, the villagers. But you have to be very, very careful when you want to buy them. You know, most of these people here, they don't work. The only source of revenue is that land that they have to sell. And once they sell the land, you know, they think that is end of life, they have a lot of money. Mm-hmm. So when they sell the land, they misuse that money. They need money. Mm-hmm. If a new buyer comes to them, they'll sell that same land. You have cases where, because if you buy a land without a title, they have to give what they call Serikal Kotume. You have cases where on 30 lands they have five different Serikal Kotume. I witnessed a very, very shameful scene when I was lawyer for one of these asifiri. After a court session, responsible people, they were exchanging about their modus operandi, how they dupe people. Mm-hmm. And how they give fake Serikal Kotume. And all these people, they're moving around freely. A lot of people have lodged complaints against them. Mm-hmm. Normally, they were supposed to be in jail. So mm-hmm. you don't know what occurred. Mm-hmm. So it's so embarrassing, it's so disheartening.
Now, I want us to come back to floods. Now, I want to ask Francis Wright. Now, how do we end this problem of floods across Cameroon and in Douala in particular? How do we resolve this problem? What should government do? What should the city council do? We have to end this problem of floods because we are in 2016 already.
We have to go back to town planning policies. Have to go back to them because we know that the city of Douala has areas, has swampy areas, which people are not supposed to build houses into. You have areas where people are supposed to build houses to. You have parts of town where people are supposed to have supermarkets. So you must respect all those things. If they're respected, we'll stop having those floods. But as long as we build anywhere all the time, we'll still have those problems.
And now that we have houses constructed haphazardly, what should be done, barrister?
The only solution is to demolish them. Let me give an example. Mm-hmm. We
demolish this house and leave the other one?
The ones that were built on areas which are not habitable. For example, we had a visit to Locals Inco with the SDO for Douala. Mm-hmm. That was 6 months ago. Was there, was holding brief for my client who is the chief of that area. When we went there, the SDO himself, he was taken aback. He said, you brought me here to come and see the urban disorder people are doing. He said they were going to demolish because they had built on the path of water, distorting the passage of water and then creating flood around Banya, which is unbearable. You don't even ask yourself, how do people live here? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They'll tell you, we should construct a dweller. But when? Mm-hmm. I myself, I look at the person who was the complainant, was embarrassed. Does this man love the family? Because if there's flood, mm-hmm. the children can be victims. So obstructed the passage of water completely. Mm-hmm. Built on water. Mm-hmm. And our brothers have been go to Mbanya, they are now selling water. They say that they are selling land, but it's water. They are selling water. Go to Mbanya, you see what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why people are buying the land. They say, no, I want to
everybody
buy
wants to build in Douala. Everyone wants to own a house in the city of Douala. Now, the issue here is that we had so many demolition exercises in the city of Douala. Even across Cameroon, people's houses were demolished. Now, how do you see the way these houses, is it proper that the government just wakes up in the morning and just starts demolishing a house, even though the people did not construct or did not like follow certain norms before constructing the houses?
Well, I think there's a process, and we all have common sense, you know. It's not enough for you to have money and go and do something. You must be vigilant. I'm buying this piece of land. Is this place habitable or not? What if tomorrow there's a road passing here? What do I do? So first of all, you need to be aware. And then now, secondly, the government usually gives time to people. They will say, I detruit. They come, they warn you. First time, second time, third time.
The government allows them to live on that land for 20, 30 years before coming to send them off the land.
But usually what happens is the very people would go and give some money. And then one of the civil servants will tell you, okay, le dossier a été abandonné. But that's never been abandonné. He's giving you the impression. Then 10 years afterwards, when new people have been appointed, they will come back to that very file. So people must be wise. You must use your common sense.
Now, Barrister, what does the law say when it concerns demolition exercise?
We talk about it depends on...
To inhabitants, to the population, do you have some rights when it has to, comes to that?
Madam, let me give you two great examples. Mm-hmm. When some demolition exercise which took place around SADP. So a lot of story buildings were mm-hmm. destroyed. These people, before coming there, some of them knew that land was a no-go area. You know, Cameroonians are stubborn. They say, nah, we're going to build a... When they want to demolish, we'll give them money. Mm-hmm. Take the case of Mabanda. Mm-hmm. These people, they had warned them, gave them about 4 notices to quit. Mm-hmm. That is why when you go to certain areas in Mabanda, they don't have land title. Even around that neighborhood, the people there, they don't have land title. So, but if you have a land title, the government, they can demolish for public utility. And if you want to demolish a public utility, this is what they call compensation. Mm-hmm. And the compensation varies. Those people with title land and people with untitled land. So the government compensates them. Like, for example, when they're trying to do the auto road, the Douala Yaoundé auto road, mm-hmm. there's compensation. Mm-hmm. Do most of the time, the money they receive,
it comes late generally.
The money, it does not even, they don't even give,
at times,
they don't even give the money to the beneficiaries, all the money. That is why
that is the
Douala Yaoundé auto road has come to a standstill. Mm-hmm. Because people are complaining that we have not received compensation. Mm-hmm. The money they are giving us, they are giving me 8,000 francs as compensation. Mm-hmm. They said it all over the television.
Yes.
How do you want to compensate someone 8,000 francs for what? Is that normal? So we have to change our mentality if we want this country to change.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Now, we had a lot of fire incidents in the year 2015, recorded here and there. We had in Sorbonne, there was a fire incident that killed at least 3 children of the same parents. We had a 62-year-old man and woman who died in a similar disaster. This is at Carrefour Ajib. We had 3 children perished from the same family at Kam Yabasi. I don't know if you know about that. And again, we had the Douala Urban Council got burnt in 2015. We also had the Douala Central Prison. Part of it got burnt in 2015. Now, why this much talk about fire incidents?
If you ask me why this much talk, I can say we are the cause of this fire incident. First of all, we have incompetent electricians. We have people who we use very bad materials when it comes to electricity. There's poor connection, poor work done. Let me give you an incident. When I was changing the air condition in my parlor, I called one young man. He told me, no, I can do it. I gave him money to go get cables. This guy went and bought Chinese cables. My house almost went on flame. So when you see, go to most of these slums, most of the quarters, the work done there in terms of electricity is poorly done. The materials that we use, the low quality materials, they are not resistant. When they are heated, they become defective. And then when the rats, they eat part of the cable, these bad quality cables, there's this exposure, and we are at risk to have fire disaster. We talk about the Douala Central Prison. I don't know if you ever been there. If you see the connection being done there, it's so deplorable.
They don't use expat.
You talk about Douala City Council, it cannot be poor work done. You don't know why somebody was trying to conceal some theft or what, so you can't say with any certainty.
All right, Barrister, I'll come back and elaborate on such cases. Now, Francis Oreda, I want to ask you, do you agree with him, the causes of our incidents in Cameroon?
Yeah.
Because we have repeated fire incidents in markets, business sites, we have private residences, we have schools. There are so much came on in 2015.
Yeah. When it comes to constructions, you have what we call standards. There's a way you build a wall for a hotel. There's a way you build the wall of a kitchen. There's a way you build the wall of toilets. Now, you cannot use the standard with which you're building a hotel room to build like my house. You can't. The cable that you use for my sitting room is not the same that you use for my kitchen. But people don't respect all those things because we live in a country where our qualifications don't count, in a country where our standards don't count. People will use any material to connect their shop to the cable or to the pool, and then tomorrow when you have a fire incident, they cry.
Because generally, they are the same causes, short circuit.
Yes.
That is what they are saying, that is short circuit. Because like Francis just said, the main issue is the poor connection and the poor materials used. Let's come back to the case of the Douala City Council. You can't say it was poor connection or poor material.
So you think somebody's responsible for the fire at the Douala City Council?
It must be somebody to cover something. Yeah, because why all these years we've not had fire there? Suddenly fire crop up in certain area of the office. Maybe they're trying to destroy some evidence which were going to be used against some suspect.
But the impact is on government.
It's on the government. Civil servants don't care. They look first at the interest. They don't look at the interest of the general public. They look at the personal interest first. That is why we suffer here in Cameroon, because they want to look at the greatest happiness of the greatest majority. Then civil servants, they will not behave the way they are behaving.
And now let's go find in a prison.
Yes.
What would cause a fire incident in a prison?
To start with, this prison was not built for this number of prisoners. It was built for a smaller number. But what do you realize today? That the prison is overpopulated. By maybe you have 10 more people, you have 10 times the number of inmates that was planned for this prison. So as a result now, people are obliged to live under very difficult conditions. In the course of that, what happens? So we have to think again. Is this the country that we want to live in?
Now, how do we solve this problem?
We don't even exclude the issue that maybe that fire was man-made, or it was put by some prisoners in order to cause their escape. Because during that fire incident, some hardened criminals escaped. So maybe they decided to set the place on fire.
In order to escape.
In order to escape.
And now, we are, since we are looking for solutions, because we don't want such things to happen in 2016.
Yes.
And the first question is, I want to ask you, what is the solution? What's the way forward? What do we do? What are you proposing to government?
We have to plan. We have to plan. We should stop fixing things as they come.
Let's take the case of markets. We're talking about how that comes, but nothing is done.
Yes.
The markets are still there.
Let's plant. We have in this country engineers, architects who've been to school to study how markets
can
be constructed.
So what should they do? Destroy the markets and restart all
the markets? Destroy the markets. Let's build markets with modern standards. I mean, when you go to other countries, you see markets which never burn. Why? Because these markets have been constructed respecting some standards. You cannot, for example, have 20 shops within, I don't know, 5 square meters. You can't. But in our country, you have 200 shops within 500 square meters. How possible is that? Then how do you expect shops not to burn?
Now, barristers, we have businesses or business sites or areas. We have markets. We have even private. They don't know how to use fire extinguishers. Is it normal?
It's not normal.
They don't even have.
We have ourselves and the authority to blame.
Why?
For we have to take the necessary precaution. For example, I have 3 fire extinguishers in my house. Mm-hmm. I have 1 in my office. But to be sincere, one of my neighbor, the house was on flame. I did not know how to manipulate the fire extinguisher. So I had to call my driver to come open it. And we, the authorities, that be like the municipal council, the urban council, we have to impose, it has to be a criteria for any shop owner that you must own a fire extinguisher.
Yes.
You must
except when, if the fire comes during the period when you are not there.
Exactly. They must control their electrical installation. They must make
sure. Yeah, who should do that?
The city council. They are the one collecting revenues from the market. They own the market.
We have the electricity company too.
No. The electricity company is the city council. Because if you go there, you see there's a lot of disorder when it comes to electrical connection in the market. Sonel cannot do that. The people themselves, you have to educate them. Because like, let me say, you own 5 shops, you own 5 meters, you want to make more money for yourself. You say, okay, bien, pay me this money, I'm going to give you, you're going to use my meter. It's not Sonel. Mm-hmm. Sonel is not there. They cannot come and control those people. Sonel, they come there to control, to give their bills, and then if there's a general problem, they come there to do the repairs. But the day-to-day problem should be left in the hands of the council.
Because people have taken precautions. Today, you don't talk about candles. People don't talk much about candles.
Candles, yes.
Now, what should people do in their homes, in their different homes? If you see fire starting somewhere, what do you do? What do they do? Do you think people should be sensitized enough?
Of course. We need to have training activities.
And who should train them? Because it's like nothing is done.
I think we have fire brigade. Maybe the fire brigade should come up with courses. Drilling exercises, whereby we are civilians, we should be trained. Say, for example, if you ever see a fire in your neighborhood, this is how you should react to it. But nothing is done. I bet you, besides fire brigades guys and maybe soldiers, no civilians knows how to handle a fire, and which is a shame.
Now, let's watch this report by Beatrice Gamo. She talks of social unrest in the year 2015.
Varied forms of dissatisfaction characterized by disgruntled workers on strike here and there also marks the year 2015 in Cameroon. Some concerning indemnities, others salaries and arrears, more working conditions and security, alongside price increase, the non-respect of engagements, and the list continues. Strike action or labor strike is a work stoppage caused by mass refusal of employees to work. Often acts to portray dissatisfaction while demanding action, a kind of atomic bomb, according to trade unionists.
Strike action is the last step when discussion fell, and most of the time 90% you are bargaining. You are bargaining to find solution to our problem. But what people return is just track action. But when you reach the level of track action, that means the problem is serious and that we don't have the answer. So last time with this minibus, when it was banned, that we were illegal, we decided to go on strike action. In a few hours, we have more than 10,000 persons in the downtown that were on the street to prevent any passage on this route. So the strike action is our atomic bomb. That means you don't want to use it frequently. Is the last solution when the government, when the employer forces us to use the strike action, because you are a partner in the labor place, and you should see what is a good cooperation between us. So you don't need frequently to go on strike action. In that morning, everyone has the occasion to cry for his parents, but you cannot daily go on cry. The life shall be with joy. And so that you can say this is the last resort. The strike action is not the last. 90% is the collective bargaining.
A strike usually takes place in response to employees' grievances.
You start, you say you have a request, you have a frequent request. After many relents, you realize that your employer didn't pay attention on what you are asking, and you realize is the work we are really producing all products. You can see even the newspaper, even food, to have transport, to have service, is what we are really, even you have million, billion, you can with your money produce goods. That means you need human capital for that. And when human capital is not satisfied with your treatment, that you are not respecting international norm of labor, you are not respecting the law, you are not respecting convention that you have with the worker, they decide to go on strike. But it's not the first step. But also as strike action, normally as African, it should be used for bargaining, as you call in French, palab. That means you should try, and if not, and it's only in if not, then you should go in strike action. For example, with the Boko Haram at the occasion you have, it's not good for us that daily you just decide to go on strike action, because inside the strike action, certain terrorists can find space and enter, kill people, and we can think that it is trade unions who are organizing this manifestation.
Most often, such actions are used to pressurize governments, employees and others to change policies. Why? At times, it is put off after positive or favorable decisions.
Generally, you can go on strike action and not having results. Remember, you just make a notice of strike action last year for the high price of fuel. As a civil servant, we obtained 5% of increase on their salary. For the certain commodity, the head of state decide for example, to reduce certain taxes. Before that, certain fuel like Lompangar Dam, when you went on strike action, at the end, you have certain benefit, that is certain increase on salary treatment or condition of work, because most of the time is not necessarily the problem of money, it's the problem of human being, of the condition of work, condition of life. That means if, for example, you have a quarter of beef in Douala, it's possible that you go on strike action and you realize that with this beginning of the year, you have some strike action of in Douala because we increased taxes in this sector. That means it's the way to force the government to come back on certain decisions that work or things that are very bad for them.
Better working and living conditions, human rights priorities of most laborers, why to them strike action is a powerful instrument?
It's a powerful instrument because so far when we are in an international conference in Switzerland, you realize that employer try to ban strike action, and you say that is human rights. that is recognized internationally. So it's the our arm in order to force those who have money, those who have the power, to remember that before that you are human beings.
For the sake of security and peace, it is most often characterized low keys, but at times goes out of control with looting and other incidents marking the events.
Now, that was a report by Beatrice Ngamu talking about social unrest in Cameroon. Now, I want to start with you, Francis Oret. Now, do you think strike action should be the best way to pressurize government to yield to certain demands?
Strike actions are usually the last resort when all negotiations have failed, when all requests for amicable arrangements have failed. Then people would always resort to strike. And from experience, when you do go on strike, the other party usually would realize the pain that you can feel. Mm-hmm. So it's not the best solution, but it's always, it tends to be the last resort.
Now, we had so many strike actions across Cameroon. Is that a solution? What does the law say about it? Is it the best means to send across a message to your employer?
What the law does not prohibit is legal, because when we look at the labor code, the 1992 labor code, it stipulates in one of its articles that the workers can go on strike to force the employers to ameliorate the working condition. They can go on strike for increase in salary, etc., etc. We also have other categories of strikes. We have like political strike, we have economic strike, we have cultural strike. Like of late, we saw how some of our military men, they went on strike, asking for their out-of-station allowances to be paid. Mm-hmm. Thank God the head of state intervened, and that allowance was paid to these people. We also have political strike when the population they decide to go on strike, clamoring for certain changes in issues concerning the society. For example, the famous strike that took place in 2008, provoked by the increase in fuel prices. Mm-hmm. We talk about strikes in schools, colleges, to force the authority that be to increase on the living condition of students, or to ameliorate certain issues which the people on strike think it is unbearable and unacceptable.
Now, seeing the military going on strike in the year 2015.
Yes.
Was that not a big risk on the part of government?
Well,
one has ever seen a military official win on strike. Yeah.
Soldiers are just human beings like all of us. They have needs, they have families, they have dreams, and all the rest. So they went on mission. That was in Bangui for 2 years, and they were supposed to be paid for that time, the time spent out. And so when they came back, they waited. Nothing happened. And so, like every human being who is claiming for his or her rights, they went down the street. And then the employer listened to them and reacted very promptly. Mm-hmm. And so we realized that going on strike or taking such actions can pay off.
That's the only way to resolve any problem if you're facing in your company. If you're not satisfied, that's just the best way. Go down the street and you say no to it. Now, I want us to talk about ritual killings and murder cases by unknown individuals. It was common in the city of Douala in Chang, reputed for ritual killings. Now, barrister, we had a lot. We had 18-year-old young women were abducted, murdered, found with brains, eyes, genitals missing. Victims were mostly girls as young as 15. Now, wild girls.
Yeah, there is a proliferation of ritual killing this what we can start innovation and the crime and the crime wave of Cameroon, because before now we sparingly talk about ritual killing, but nowadays it's so common, especially in Chang taking the lead.
And businessmen are mostly involved.
And they don't kill, they kill because the threat in this human part, the threat in this human part. So when they kill them, especially girls, they start first by raping them. After satisfying their malicious sexual drive, they now kill them, extract certain parts which they are going to commercialize. So, you know, it's a new and unacceptable form of business, because they don't remove this part to go and keep them in a laboratory. They remove this part to sell and then to get make money for themselves.
In the city of Douala, for example, had a 28-year-old girl, Tabuna Musadi, that was raped, murdered. We had an 18-year-old girl that was raped, murdered in Bepanda. We had so many other cases. Now, who takes responsibility of it? Who should be blamed for this? Is this an indication that our security forces are no longer working?
Well, you cannot have a policeman behind every Cameroonian, or a gendarme soldier behind every Cameroonian. What's happening is what we are noticing today is simply the consequence of something which started up, some years ago. Today, people are getting involved with so many cults, what you call sects and everything. There are people belong to some strange circles, some strange churches, where they are told or they are promised that if they come with X or Y, they'll be giving money, they'll be giving fame, they'll be giving us so many things. And these people now maliciously get involved in this horror. So the first thing to do is, first of all, we need to raise awareness. Those young girls who would go with a man because he has promised them 20,000, 200,000. You don't know somebody, you simply because he has said hello to you, and then you happily go and pay him a visit in his hotel room. Because in most cases, these men don't go into houses and get these girls. They get them on the streets. So we have a problem of moral decadence. What are the lessons that these young girls are being told? What is the story? Is it making money the essence of life? When a young girl sees a flashy car and then she begins to envy, what happens? The case in Chang, I was fortunate to listen to the report of one of your colleagues. What happens is there was a man who was after a young girl, and this young girl was dating that man until the day he invited the girl to his bedroom, and she went along with a friend. And unfortunately, he killed both of them. So we have a problem of moral decadence, because we would address this issue at a very low level, it won't solve the problem. We need to go back to the root. What is happening in our society today?
Now, Barrister, is it proof that our security measures are wanting?
No. When it comes to security, when we talk about security, our police, we are one of the best in the world.
Yes.
You know, when it comes to United Nations system, Cameroon, we have the best police force with the UN.
But the crime wave is on the rise in the city of Douala across Cameroon?
It's on the rise because we ourselves, we don't cooperate with the police people. We don't denounce criminals. We don't denounce suspects we see around our neighborhood. So we have to help the police people to do their work. The number of inhabitants outnumber the number of police people in our city. So we have to help the police people, the gendarmes, to reduce the level of crime wave in our city. Notwithstanding, most of the police people are corrupt, but they've been doing some great job.
Now, I want to ask you, are security forces doing enough to secure the life of citizens?
Well, I'm not a security specialist, but I think they are doing what they can do with the means that they have. Though I believe they could...
You think the means is not sufficient?
Not sufficient. When you have a thief break into your house, when you call the police station, they tell you, we don't have fuel. If you can buy fuel, we'll come. Some will tell you, we don't have enough guns. this is not a joking matter, but mm-hmm. what we need to do is we need to realize that our police force needs further training. Mm-hmm. When I see most police guys spend nights in bars, drinking the whole night, so are they even aware that they are here for our security? Do they realize that each 30 days they go to the bank, get a salary because they were hired to save us? Do they even realize that? So I think there is a general problem of moral decadence. Mm-hmm. The police force don't know what they're there for.
They're not doing enough.
They're not doing enough. They complain about the means that they don't even have. But what do they really do with the list that they have?
Now, if the population starts denouncing, do you think it's going to solve the problem? It's going to reduce the crime wave in Douala and across Cameroon? If inhabitants are really involved denouncing any suspicious person?
Yeah, it's going to greatly reduce the number of criminals. And if the number of criminals are reduced, the crime wave is going to diminish.
And if they denounce, will they come on time? Will they act on time?
When we say denounce, you
because
see somebody...
Because at times you denounce, you don't act on time. No, so that's what the population are complaining.
When we say denounce, it's not only when the offense is being committed. You see somebody suspicious around your neighborhood. You see him, he gets up early in the morning, roaming in the quarter, and the night he leaves and goes out. You don't know what he's doing. You can call the police people that there's somebody who's suspicious who lives in this neighborhood.
Now, let's
that
take
is one way of helping mm-hmm. the police people to mm-hmm. fight this crime, crime wave. Mm-hmm. You have some parents, they know their children are bandits. They keep them there. When they come and arrest them, they say, no, my child, no, he's not a bandit. So we ourselves, we have to help the police in order to reduce mm-hmm. this crime wave.
Now, we are starting a new year. We are in 2016, and we have a new governor.
Yes.
Who is barely, let's say, 5 months old into office. Now, what should he do?
Well, I think he knows exactly what to do. Because he's been doing it for so many years. But the problem is they don't implement decisions on time. I witnessed something this week and last week in my neighborhood. Police forces and urban council agents, they came into my neighborhood and they were just destroying all call boxes, little shops around the road. And then in the evening, I saw the very call boxes and everything. They came back. This morning, as I got up, I was even scared because the number of policemen that I saw on my street, I thought there was a security problem. Just for me to realize that they just came to send away those very call box people. Now, do you need to deploy police force early morning just to send those people away? No. So where we need our police forces, we don't see them. But where we don't need them, I mean, you don't need three vehicles of policemen, about 20 policemen, just to fight 10 little girls who own car boxes. You don't need that.
Don't you think our security forces need to undergo more trainings? Because happened to have witnessed a scene around BP City where there was a fight. Security forces came, they were afraid, they went back. And gendarmerie officers had to come and they had to look for a way to handle the problem. Now, don't you think our police force, they have a problem?
I don't want to see the force in this society has a problem. Some of the police people, they have a problem. They have a problem with the mentality. problem with the way they exercise their duties, because I don't think when the people came there, maybe they realized that there were some couples or people they knew and then decided to go back to bed. Mm-hmm. Because I want to say we have one of the best police force.
But they need to act and act on time. Now, I would like us to revisit the stampede in Mecca, which killed more than 200 Cameroonians, let's say close to 300 Cameroonians. You happen to have witnessed the scene now.
Yeah.
How do you react to that? Because you are going to have a more Muslims going for another trip.
Yes.
It's 2016.
Yes. It was very sad and heartbreaking for people to go on pilgrimage and find death. Mm-hmm. Nobody would ever wish that. According to reports from Mecca and from authorities of Saudi Arabia, it was a misunderstanding. Between the Muslims, and so which caused that stampede. So maybe people should be more careful. You know, usually if I hear somebody shouting next door, I wouldn't want to know why she's shouting. I'll simply run away. And maybe the danger is coming from my direction. So that's one problem. And secondly, maybe Saudi authorities need to take real measures. Why do all those people go there at the same time of the year? Can't we have like periods in the year when people can go on pilgrimage? Because, 500 years ago, it wasn't a problem. But today, in 2016, the population, the crowd that goes
too much.
Is too much. And imagine 20 years from now, there will even be more people. Because increasingly, people can afford a plane ticket to go to Mecca. People can afford the hotel room for, say, 2 weeks or a month. Mm-hmm. So increasingly, you have more and more people. So such accidents, if we don't take care of proper measures, may simply multiply.
Would occur again in this 2016.
Yes.
Now, I want to ask you, Barista, who should be blamed for the stampede in Mecca? Or who is responsible for the stampede?
We have to know the cause of the stampede before We have to know the cause of the stampede before we apportion blame. Mm-hmm. Where did the government, where did they go wrong? You have to tell me where the government went wrong. The population, what happened, what causes the stampede, what provoked the stampede? Mm-hmm. Was it the pilgrim themselves? If they are the one who caused this, they provoke the stampede, we have to blame them. What did the government do to provoke or to cause the stampede? We don't know. But we know the pilgrim themselves, they provoke the stampede. And unfortunately, many of them died in that stampede. But I want to say it was an act of God. It was supposed to happen like that. The government was not there. They didn't know that there was going to be a stampede. Because if they knew there was going to be a stampede, they would have taken precautionary measures.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like Francis said, there was a cry somewhere, an alarm by some of the people, which now caused total disorder.
Mm-hmm.
And then
as more people got in?
Yeah, more people got in and then they made their water.
Now, how do you appreciate government's measure or strategy to condole with the victims of and family of victims? Or measures to identify Cameroonians who were still in Mecca?
I heard in the news that the president offered some financial compensation to the families of the victims, but I wonder if that was enough. I think here we have to question our security. How many Cameroonians went to Mecca do we know, first of all? And if we do know, have we identified the families? Because today we are in like...
Up to the moment, some families, some victims have not been identified.
Identified, yes. So does it mean that when people decide to go on
pilgrimage,
they're not registered? if that's true, I don't want to believe
that. But there is
that,
a committee in charge.
Yes, I don't want to believe that those people have not been registered properly. Because if that's the case, then we live in a very funny country. Mm-hmm. Now, how come many weeks after the stampede, we are still to identify some of the pilgrims?
Mm-hmm. Now, Barrister, what are the measures that government should take to save or protect Muslims who will be going for another pilgrimage this 2016? Because more will still go.
We talk about.
And what should the Saudi authorities to do? Because they talked of taking measures. What measures should they take?
Yeah, it's better we talk about the people out there taking measures, not our government. We can, the government of Cameroon can only sensitize their citizens mm-hmm. to be cautious, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. to be vigilant. We cannot take any measures because it's not our territory. Mm-hmm. The host, the people receiving the pilgrim, they have to take proper security measures. They have to provide decent accommodation ground and a bigger accommodation space for the pilgrims. I think they can reduce the number of pilgrims, like Francis said, if they can divide the visit there. Mm-hmm. Into if they can cause,
let's say five times in a year
to avoid this
to
avoid this congestion, mm-hmm. because mm-hmm. the main reason for this stampede was because the place was overcrowded.
Yes.
And there was the distress cry,
yes,
which caused panic, fear, mm-hmm. and then people started running, and then that had to cause the stampede.
I'm sure your message has gone through. Let's watch this report by Beatrice Ngamo on some major health events in 2015.
One of the big news of the year 2015 in the health sector is that Cameroon was declared free from polio transmission. Though she needs to maintain vigilance through a satisfactory surveillance based on national and international norms, alongside supplementary vaccination activities.
For a country to be classified as free for polio is a whole process which can last for more than 3 years. In fact, when we consider the case of Cameroon, we have the last cases in 2014. Since 2014, there is no more new cases. But now we are in the pre-classification of as country which is not more transmitted polio, and we are supposed to continue to follow the situation at least for 3 years before our request can be sent to the regional headquarters to see if Cameroon can be classified as free for polio. We are not more transmitted polio, but we are supposed to continue to follow up to look for new cases, because it can happen that we have some cases somewhere. Because when you go through the vaccination coverage, our vaccination coverage now as routine vaccination is less than 90%. So when you have a vaccination coverage with less than 90%, when you consider the whole population of 100%, you have 10% who are not covered, and you can have a virus among the 10%. This is why it's true that we have stopped transmission, but we are supposed to continue to be very, very aware of what is happening in the whole country, because we still have a very huge population of children who are not vaccinated in a routine campaign. The situation of the neighboring country is another problem, because if we in Cameroon, we are not more transmitted. Polio, for instance, and we have many cases in the neighboring country, we are not safe, because due to the communication, we can still have some cases who are coming from the neighboring country. You can leave from Yaoundé today, and before the evening, you are in Equatorial Guinea, or in Gabon, or Congo. So if the communication here are well, we are not free. This is why we are supposed to work in the whole system as a region, central region, for instance, to be sure that if we have stopped transmission in Cameroon, the Central Africa, the Chad, Gabon, Equatorial Guinea, they are not more have cases of polio in their country.
Last year also, the mass distribution of long-lasting insecticide-treated bed nets was introduced anew. After that, in 2011.
In fact, the last time that long-lasting bed net were distributed, it was in 2011, and they were supposed to stay for 2 years. This is why normally in 2015 we were supposed to give a new batch of long-lasting mosquito bed net. In fact, because the product, the insecticide which is used for it, cannot go more than 3 years, cannot stay more than 3 years. So after 3 years, to have to continue to have the same efficiency, we need to change. We need to give a new one. This is why this year they have organized a campaign to give new bed net in the whole country.
Okay.
And another aspect of the problem is that the quantity was given in 2011 was not enough for the total population. It was less than 10 million. And we have in Cameroon, we are more than 20 million. So if you consider at least that we have a one bed net for two people, you see that in 2011, there were some people who were not covered. This is why most of the time it was the pregnant women and children and so on who were the targets were used for the distribution of 2011.
What some Cameroonians are still to better understand till date is why Cameroon was chosen among countries for the Ebola virus clinical trial to run from October 2015 to 2016.
A lot of consideration to choose country in the trials. Normally, the first situation was that we were supposed to be a country who have not have a case of Ebola. This is the first thing. And secondly, when we Cameroon did not have a case of Ebola, but we have a case of Ebola, cases of Ebola in Nigeria. We have many cases in Port Harcourt. Port Harcourt is not far from Limbe. And you know how population are moving from Port Harcourt to Limbe and from Limbe to Port Harcourt. So we are not safe of it. This is the first situation. And secondly, when the country is supposed to go on, we must know that, for instance, today we are using a polio vaccine. Some countries have gone into the trials so that we can have the polio vaccine. Why you people, Cameroonians, you don't want Cameroon people to go in so that the other country can benefit you?
Talking about benefits, three new hospitals were inaugurated in 2015. The San Melima Reference Hospital, the Yaoundé Emergency Center, and the Douala Gynaco Obstetric and Pediatric Hospital. This also as Daryl and Davis, a conjoined twin, transferred to Tunisia, were successfully separated upon and are presently at the Chantal Biya Foundation.
Thank you, Beatrice Ngamo, for that major health events that happened in 2015. Back in the studio, I have as a guest two gentlemen, Francis Eret and Barrister Agwango. Now, I'll begin with you, Francis. What are some of the major health events that marked in 2015?
Well, we had the various campaigns of polio vaccine. Mm-hmm. I have three children. Mm-hmm. Two are underage, and they were vaccinated about five or six times in the course of the...
Did it really
disturb you? Well, at some point, I started questioning the vaccine because, I mean, we know that people are normally supposed to be vaccinated once or twice, mm-hmm. but when it happens five times, I would ask myself, do children back in my village mm-hmm. in Ewole have been vaccinated? Yes, for children in Douala mm-hmm. and in the Bonaparte neighborhood mm-hmm. to receive five times the same vaccine.
When there are other children.
When there are other children in rural areas. So we had that, and then we had this Ebola issue.
Now, it's a polio vaccine that had to take place across Cameroon now. Barrister, were you really disturbed to the polio vaccines that were administered to children more than five times in a year?
I can't think the because like the people in their schools before they administered the vaccines, they send a message to the parents informing them that there's a team from the Minister of Public Health which is going to pass by in our establishment to administer this polio vaccine. For example, when they wrote to me, I wrote back to the school authority informing them that my daughter, she has been administered that vaccine. But I don't wish that they should give her a second dose of
vaccine. What were your reasons for doing that?
No, because my children always follow up their vaccines very closely. Because it depends on where the children are delivered, because you have a, what they call vaccination card.
But it concerns all children, even if you administer the vaccine.
No, no, you cannot give somebody the same vaccine four times when the effects are still going to be the same. Thank God I have in my family, I have doctors. So when there are issues like that, I always call either my in-law or I call my niece. I say, see, my daughter received vaccine on this date and I received a message that they're going to administer them another vaccine. Is this proper? They always advise me on that.
Now, don't you think it's proper for government to give such vaccines to children because they want to ensure a 100% vaccination rate?
Yes, but we need to be organized.
If we have 90% vaccination rate and 10% has not been touched, don't you see there is a problem?
There is a problem in terms of coverage. It's not enough to administer vaccines to children in Yaoundé and Douala. Cameroon is not just Yaoundé and Douala. Cameroon is Mara. Cameroon is Belabo. Is Baturi. All those areas.
And Fonfuka.
Yes. Do we actually make sure that children from those remote areas also receive the vaccine? That's the question.
So the problem is not the vaccine. The problem is that the team should be organized, make sure that everybody takes the vaccine. Because the problem is with the vaccination rate, the vaccination coverage, which is yet to reach 100%. And what should government do if they have to reach a 100% vaccination rate?
They have to go to the hinterlands. They have to go everywhere.
Yes.
They don't have to concentrate only in Douala and Yaoundé.
Because the teams are not always health experts.
Yes, most of them they are not, which is it can lead to a health hazard. So it's deplorable for government.
But they are trained for that.
It's deplorable for government to send amateurs to go and administer vaccine on children who are so vulnerable. They should get experts, send them on the field, and they should send this expert to other areas of the country. Not only they should not be limited within the cities of Douala and Yaoundé.
Now, let's talk about these Ebola clinical trials.
Yes.
In 2015.
Yeah.
Cameroon was declared free from Ebola. And why the Ebola? Seeing the Ebola clinical trials, did it disturb you?
Well,
so many people from Bamenda complained, the population complained. Yeah. Some of them were like scared about the vaccine.
Now we don't know how effective the trials have been. We need some time, maybe a year or two, to find out. But from the interview that I watched on TV by experts from World Health Organization and our local hospitals, they said it was something normal. It was something normal, but we need time, like a year or two, to find out if it was well done or not, and what may be the consequences.
And you test it on an individual to find out if it's going to have a long-lasting effect?
It depends on the mode of application. If it entails that this drug should be tested on a human being, they have to test it on a human being. And one of the reasons they came here because Cameroon is an Ebola-free country.
Mm-hmm.
So they wanted to test this drug in an area which has not been hit by this Ebola virus.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we have qualified medical personnel, qualified medical doctors, who can advise the government either to accept or to refute the testing of this vaccine. So if the government allowed this vaccine to be tested, it means it received advice from this health expert.
Which means the population, we're not supposed to be scared about it because we had health experts who were conducting it.
They were scared because they're ignorant. And a lot of rumor mongers spreading false rumors.
Yeah.
About the testing of the Ebola vaccine. Mm-hmm. I don't think the government of Cameroon can accept the testing of vaccine in Cameroon, which is going to be detrimental to the population. I don't think the government of Cameroon can do that.
But don't you think there's a problem of communication here?
Yes, for sure, because you have those people who are always ready to spread, you know, to spread evil news, like wildfire, and then you have the medical doctors who are qualified to say things. But now, do people listen to medical doctors? Did the media, was the media involved in this process? Because I think that we needed some time, you know, to announce in the media, to go down to the field and inform people of what was going to happen. But when people get the news the same day, of course people get scared. I know in the past we see had such rumors of the government trying to do what with Anglophone girls in order to stop you know, so many things. People are very creative, you know, when it comes to negativity. So I think the government should be taking more time to sensitize
the population.
And I only think when you're talking about sensitization, we have to talk about decentralization, because when there's decentralization, we can better manage the people we govern.
Yes.
Because the council, they can be the most appropriate forum for this sensitization.
Yes.
Because like the journalists, most of them, they do not want to go to the hinterland.
Yes.
But when we now involve the council, the palace, the paramount chief, the sub chiefs, the priest, the headmasters, teachers,
mm-hmm.
I think this we're going to disseminate the information.
Mm-hmm.
So we need to change the strategy when it comes to sensitizing the population about certain issues.
Now, three new hospitals were inaugurated in 2015. We're talking about the Douala Gynaco Obstetric Hospital, we're talking about the Sangna Reference Hospital, and the Yaoundé Emergency Center. Now, my question is that proof that government is doing something or is doing, is bent on ensuring the health of its citizens?
Okay, that's a good question. What has become of it used to be called provincial hospitals, and today I think they call them
regional hospitals.
Mm-hmm. Now, what has become of those hospitals? Are they still operational?
Yeah.
Are they well equipped? Do they have enough staff? Because creating a new hospital is not the solution. Why not reinforce the former one? Why not make sure that you have better equipment, you have more staff in the former one before creating the new one? Because very soon, 5 years from now, these new hospitals will become old enough and will no longer be of service to the population. So we keep building new things and not maintaining the old ones.
Now, do you agree with him?
I think the hospital Maureen is talking about, these are specialized
hospitals.
They are different from our regional hospitals.
But he has raised a problem.
Yeah, I know. Like, for example, the new hospital which was inaugurated by the Prime Minister.
The Gynaco Obstetric Hospital?
Yeah, was put in place to take care especially of women, pregnant women. I'm not saying it's an innovation, because we have the General Hospital, we have La Quintini,
yes.
We have district hospitals,
mm-hmm.
which have been taking care of women, and then we have pregnant women, but the new hospital is a specialized and more equipped with sophisticated equipment. The regional hospitals, they are still in existence, like the one in St. Malima. It's not a regional hospital, it's a hospital in San Marima.
Yes.
But they decided to open a specialized, more equipped, more sophisticated hospital to take care of the people of the population of the South region.
Is it proper for government? It is a good thing to construct a more specialized hospital, but should government also abandon the regional hospital or the district hospitals? Because if you get into the villages, we have hospitals that the structure is there, you don't have a medical doctor, infrastructure, equipment, there is nothing. Is that proper?
It's not proper. We talk about mentality, you don't talk about the government. The minister of public health cannot go around the country controlling the number of nurses or the doctors who are manning hospital in our villages. For example, you transfer somebody to a village called Menkaf in Metro Division, a medical doctor, he goes there, negotiate with the district officer, ask for permission. He goes and stay, for example, in a womb or in Bamenda, or in goes somewhere doing his private job. Who do you want to blame? You don't blame the minister, you blame the people there. They have to complain. At times you complain. The hierarchy, they don't react. So you see, it's a problem of mentality. It's a problem of commitment.
At times you have these structures are there. The doctors are there, but the equipment are not there.
Yes.
You have somebody leave a village and come to Douala for treatment.
Yes.
Now, how do you analyze this? Or what's your take on this?
I was thinking that the solution was to, upgrade our hospitals, create new units, highly specialized units. Take the case of a school. You would have a grammar school, and then after many years, it becomes a high school. So we are using the same structure, but we're simply upgrading. So you would leave a hospital like La Quintini to go to a highly specialized hospital, which in most cases will be more expensive. Then you need to appoint new medical doctors. You need to buy new equipment. And then 5 years down the line, that hospital becomes useless. In Douala, we have what we call the general hospital, which is supposed to be a reference hospital. But why, besides that, we still need a highly specialized health center? So is it less general hospital than it used to be before?
and barrister, can Cameroonians afford specialized hospital, looking at their conditions today, their living condition?
You know, when you're hit by this ailment, you have to do everything to foot your bills by going to this specialized hospital. Like Francis said, we have the Douala Reference Hospital, also known as the Douala, the General, L'Hôpital General. But the new hospital it's not for general illnesses. Mm-hmm. It's a particular illnesses. So I think that hospital has its place. Mm-hmm. We are not abandoning the old structures. Like for example, if you go to the Bamenda Regional Hospital, there are other specialized units. They have added there. Like he said, they have to upgrade. They have upgraded the Bamenda General Hospital. You go to the Boya Regional Hospital, it has been upgraded, though not to a certain level. So I think the creation of new hospital does not stop the government from upgrading or improving on the old structures.
The government has not been doing that. Government, it seems...
I can't... you are saying it has not been doing that, but if you go to the Bamenda Hospital...
Because we have reports in other villages, in other smaller towns where the health centers have been abandoned and inhabitants have to leave, trek for kilometers, some even come to Douala for treatment. Now, we have more hospitals that have been constructed by government. The cost of treatment is still very high. Why? Don't you think government can do something about it?
Well, I think health and education are the
can it not be subsidized?
Yeah, health and education are the sectors that... most governments in the world do subsidize, but in our country it isn't. Why? I don't know. People live in abject poverty. A lot of people in Cameroon, I don't know the percentage, but they live with less than $1 per day. So when they are ill, they go to hospital and they have a bill of 10,000. They can die because they can't afford 10,000 francs CFA. Mm-hmm. So what's the government doing? I don't know the health policy in our country, but people badly need support from the government.
Now, can't we have free health services in Cameroon?
But you know, to the best of my knowledge, there are certain decrees passed by the government where children of certain age and certain categories of person were to be treated for free.
Talking of malaria.
Yes, it's something. That is the number one killer disease, malaria. Number one killer disease, but the issue is that of mentality. Is it applicable? The answer is in the negative. There are fixed charges which we're supposed to pay in our various hospitals. But when you go there, these people, they don't respect this barrier. If you give them that same amount of money, they'll let you there. If even you want to die, they'll say, okay. If you don't give them what they call bribe, they'll not attend to you. So who do you want to blame? We have ourselves to blame. Let me give you another example. If you go to the various courthouses, there are prices that they have affixed to different services to be rendered. There are things that if you want to obtain from the court, like a ruling, they say you have to pay 1,500 francs. They bet you, if you give that 1,500 francs, you wait for 3 months. And when you need, if you need that document, what do? You go and negotiate with them for them to give you. The price is 10 times more than the official price. They don't even give you any receipt. That is what is being obtained to in our hospital. Go to La Quintini. This cankerworm of corruption has eaten deep in the fabric. So the doctors, the nurses, everybody there, even the people there at the gate. You want to get into the hospital, they want to bribe them. You go to La Quintini for them to give you a bed, you want to pay for a room, they want to bribe you.
Is this issue of court?
Yeah, red code, code of rouge. Yes.
So we have ourselves mentality.
Now, is there no solution to that?
Well, here we're discussing symptoms of a very, very big problem. Symptoms are just symptoms. Let's go deep inside. Yeah? What's the salary of a medical doctor in Cameroon? Do you know? What's the salary of a high school teacher? Do you know? What's the salary of a nurse, a qualified nurse in Cameroon? They have families to feed. They have kids to send to school.
So it's normal for them to act that way?
It's not normal, but circumstances are pushing them to act that way.
So you think they have a better pay package?
Yeah, they will change.
It will resolve the problem?
They will change. I remember when I was still a child, when I was like 5 or 6, corruption was not as widespread as today. But all this began to happen in the early 90s. Yes. What happened? Go back in history. You will find the answers. I mean, you can't expect a teacher who earns 40,000 to live decently. You can't expect that. Back in my days, when I was in college, teachers had cars. They had these Peugeot cars, these Renault. They had cars. But today, they go to school on motorbikes.
Now, is it possible? How is it possible to sanction or to erase corruption in the health milieu?
We can. It's impossible to talk about to discard completely of corruption in the health milieu in Cameroon. It's extremely difficult. We're talking about to reduce to a minimum level because this corruption has eaten very deep into the fabrics of the society. Mm-hmm. For example, if we create a committee in a hospital. These people, they're human beings. They'll come there the first 3 months. they will do their job with a lot of due diligence. After that, they themselves will come as corrupt, as the people that have been sent to control. So it's a problem of mentality. Secondly, people should always report.
People don't denounce.
And when you don't cry foul, you don't denounce, you let it go, you abet this act of corruption. Mm. But when we sensitize Cameroonians to fight against these ills, to write to the authorities that be, a lot of things will be for the better of Cameroonians.
Now, briefly before we talk on education, very briefly, I want to have your appreciation on the successful separation of conjoined twins. So watching the images.
Yeah.
How did you feel when you got the images or when you got news that the twins have been separated?
To me, it was a miracle. Mm-hmm. It was a miracle. I'm a Christian.
And generally, we have those children or such children from very poor parents,
yes.
From poor backgrounds.
Backgrounds, yes. Mm-hmm. I think it was a miracle. It's good. Medicine is moving on. It's moving on very well, and we have a lot of miracles like that.
Now, Baris, I want to ask you, why is it that we have such children coming just from the Northwest region? It might sound, the question might sound very bizarre, but why? Because we don't hear from any other region, just from the Northwest region. Why? Yeah, they have particular things they eat, or science can better explain that.
It's an act of God which we cannot question. We can't question an act of God. So the Almighty knows why it's happening in that particular area of the country.
Mm-hmm. Now, the education sector also witnessed a lot of changes in the year 2016. It started with a change of minister. We had from Louise Bapes to Jean-Ernest Ngale Bibehe. And then his first sanction as minister, he has sanctioned close to 200 teachers for fraud and other malpractices.
Yes.
Now, what's your reaction to that?
Well, it's a good initiative, but is that enough? How many teachers are guilty of that? And how many have been sanctioned? 200. No, it's not even 10%. It's not even 10%. Yes.
Now, is a sanction, is it timely? How timely is the sanction?
Well, timely, taking into consideration the number of years he has been in that post. We know teachers in our days, we used to look up to them as respectable people. Mm-hmm. We should look at them like the models of society. Mm-hmm. But what has been obtained today is not the same of what was being obtained 20 years ago.
Now, is there no possibility of eliminating fraud in the education sector?
Well, that's a very difficult question and a difficult project, because we live in a society, and the corruption that we're facing today goes from health sector, educational sector, economic sector. All the sectors have been affected, and education cannot handle that in isolation. So we are dealing with a global problem, so we need a global solution from the top to the bottom.
Is there no solution to corruption in the education milieu?
Madam, we cannot talk of total solution. We talk of reducing corruption to a minimum level, because these people, part of them, this act of corruption is part of their life. Once we put into place measures to combat this corruption, they develop other measures to cause act of corruption. So what we should do, we should try to reduce it to a minimum level. We cannot reduce corruption in Cameroon, madam.
Now
we are fooling ourselves.
No, the GCE board was concerned. We talked about corruption in the official examination. We're talking about advanced level, ordinary level, talking about the GCE board. And people criticized very much in 2015 the means of in which GCE board sent out results. Now, What's your take on that?
I think on that, the people managing the disabled, we have to explain.
Because they use mobile phone companies to send out results.
They use mobile phone companies to send out results, mm-hmm. and you don't know the set of mind of these people of the mobile phone company.
The students who waited three days before they had their results.
We should follow or maintain mm-hmm. the normal principle, normal custom and practice. What we have been using before now, mm-hmm. we should forget about this sophisticated method.
Which method? But technology is advancing.
It's advancing. It's not in every aspect, not to publish result. We see, we use technology. We use computer now in our classes, but to publish result, we don't need to go through these mobile companies. Why can't we maintain what we have been using for all these years? When we were in school, I never heard about corruption after the GC. But now, it's so common. It's embarrassing. And it's so disturbing. If we know, if we're using the mobile companies, before, during, or after, mm-hmm. and it's posing problem or causing problem, we should avoid it.
We have the three means of sending out our results. We have the radio, the newspapers still remain, and yes. we have the mobile phone companies who are to send out results. But the newspapers are delayed in carrying out the results. Mm-hmm. So students had to use the mobile phone companies, but this delayed. Do you think the GC board should use just one method to send out results?
I think in the past.
Knowing that technology is advancing?
Yes.
And they're following technology?
Yeah, it's not because technology is advancing that in 2016 results will be WhatsApp. Example. WhatsApp. No, I think we have to be serious. We have to be serious. Mm-hmm. Countries like the USA or Britain, where this technology has been used for decades, mm-hmm. are still publishing results through newspapers and on some specific radio stations. Mm-hmm. That's what we should do. It's as simple as that. Because we're trying to fight fraud, but by releasing exams through SMSs, how sure are you that they're authentic?
Now, also had the strike of Catholic school teachers. Some of them have been working for close to 30 years with a pay package of 30,000 francs CFA. The strike went on for days. No. Barrister, how did you react to that?
I think I was even a victim because I have one of my adopted son. He has been with me. The kid sister is attending the Catholic school, St. Peter and Paul. And for some days, I saw her at home, and I sought to know why she's not going to school. She was not going to school. She told me they were on strike. And when I sought to find out to know why the teachers were on strike, they were complaining about the poor pay package. But to me, I was embarrassed because the school fees in that school, I went to Catholic school, Big Mancon. See, we in those days we were paying less than 2,000 francs, but today in that school the school fees there is about 60,000 francs, and I don't know why the Catholic they should be an example. The mission, not only the Catholic, mm-hmm. because I know the Catholic they are better than the Protestant and Baptist. These people who are very closer to God should be a model. They should be an example. So if I think they have the money. Should reduce expenditure elsewhere and try to increase the salary of the teachers.
Now, Francis, what is the problem with the education system, Cameroon's educational system today?
Lack or absence of planning to start with. And then secondly, we have a lot of people who came into the educational field because they're looking for money. Not because they love their job, not because it's their vocation, not because it's their passion. So when you have such people in a field, usually they will focus solely on money, mm-hmm. and then you have all these problems coming up. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So today I think we need to have serious educational policy. We need to make sure that the people who are in the educational sector really love education and they want to devote their life, you know, for that. And you will not have such things as low salaries in the educational sector. You will not have such things as fraud, mm-hmm. because when a teacher has taught a child for 9 months, a good teacher, he will never find it reasonable to still go and show papers to that child on the eve of the exam. No, he wouldn't do that. But when you have adventurers, people who have come into the field to make money, okay, yeah. they will go buy those papers, come and sell back to the students. So we are responsible for what is happening today.
So what should government do, Barrister? We are rounding up the program. We're talking about the educational system. We're talking about the education sector. What should be done to ameliorate the sector?
For the government to ameliorate this sector, first of all, they have to ameliorate the standard of living of these teachers. They have to better the condition. Once this is done, I think it's going to reduce to a minimum level all these ills we witness in this sector.
Now, I want to thank you, Francis Eret, for honoring our invitation.
You're welcome.
And I want to thank you, Barrister Wango, for honoring our invitation.
Thank you, Maureen, for giving me the opportunity.
And to you out there, we thank you for watching Retrospective 2015, stay in the company of our programs.